In this lecture, we will discuss the duality property of continuous time Fourier transform, and we will also discuss some problems related to this concept. Or we'll see how we can apply the duality problem to solve the continuous time Fourier transform questions. And first, we will discuss the duality property by using mathematical equation. So for the simplicity, here we will represent the Fourier transform of the signal x of t as x of omega. Usually we will represent x of j omega. For the simplicity or the convenience, I will represent x of omega in this particular case for explaining duality property. So don't get confused. Both are some representations. There is no other significance for the x of j omega or x of omega. And if there is a signal x of t and the continuous time Fourier transform of the signal is represented by capital X of omega. This is small x of t, and this is uppercase letter x, okay, x of omega. Then, by using duality property, we can find the Fourier transform of the signal x of t, that is uppercase letter, that's another function, x of capital X of t is written as 2 pi into x of minus omega. So this is actually a duality property. So by using equation, it's very difficult to explain. So I will choose one of the non-signals. And by using this example, I will explain what you mean by the duality property or what the concept is. See, in this particular figure, you can see one rectangular pulse, x1 of t. I can represent this rectangle signal as rectangle t by t1. Or 2t1 because the width of the pulse is 2t1. So this is a time domain signal that is x1 of t. Okay. And if you find the Fourier transform of this particular signal, we already discussed the transform of rectangular pulse. And by using the standard equation, I can write the result of this question 2t1. It becomes sinc omega t1. So by using the standard result that we already discussed in the previous lectures, the transform of rectangular t by or rectangular pulse will be a sinc function, and this is a standard form. Okay, if the width of the pulse is 2t1, the amplitude will be 2t1. And here you can see there is another signal. So one more thing you should understand, this is a time domain representation of signal, and this is a frequency domain representation. Frequency domain representation. Here the variable is t, and here the variable is omega. Okay. So you got the transform, which is x1 of j omega, transform of x1 of j. Now we can see that there is another signal, which is again in time domain. It looks like a sinc function in time domain, which is represented as x2 of t. Okay. So this signal I can represent by using the equation. If it is W, we can write W by, or I will write it, this is T1. This is also T1. This is also T1. Okay. T1. T1. Okay. So this signal I can write T1 by pi sinc in time domain, and it's T1. So this is a sinc function in time domain. And if you observe these two functions, you can see some similarity of the waveform shape. Okay. Some amplitude difference is there, but otherwise the shape of the waveform is same. So again, it's a time domain signal. And if you find the Fourier transform of this particular sinc function, you will get some result by using the equations. And here you can see that the result is again a rectangle pulse. So the Fourier transform of this particular function will result into a rectangle pulse in a frequency domain, that is rectangle omega by 2t1. Okay. So from this particular example, you can see that there is a similarity between the transform in time domain and frequency domain for the waveform shape. So if you find the Fourier transform of a signal in time domain, and in this particular case is a rectangle pulse, and you will get a sync function as a result. And if you find the transform of a sync function, and the result will be a rectangle pulse in the frequency domain. So this similarity is actually indicated by the duality property. So by using the duality property also, you can find the result of this particular function. See here, there's a rectangle pulse, which is represented as rectangle t by 2t1. And by using this duality property, we can say that x of t will be written as 2 pi into x of minus omega. So here you can see that there is a rectangle pulse in time domain, a rectangle t by 2t1. Okay. And the transform of this particular signal is represented by 2t1 sync omega t1. And now we need to find the inverse Fourier transform of a rectangle pulse. So we'll see how we can approach this particular question. So we need to find the inverse Fourier transform of a rectangle pulse or the Fourier transform of a sync function. So by using this particular relation, we know that if there is a signal in this particular form, so this is 2t sync omega t1 is in frequency domain. If you write a similar signal in time domain, it becomes 2t1 sync in time domain, it's t1. So that is actually x of t. This is actually x of omega, and this is more x of t. And if you write x of t in time domain, that is a capital X of t, the result will be something like this, 2 pi into x of minus omega. That is 2 pi into x of minus omega means here x of t is rectangle t by 2 t1, and we need to substitute t is equal to minus omega. Then you will get 2 pi, it's a rectangle minus omega by 2t1. Okay, so this is a rectangle pulse, is an even function, so there is no importance for this minus. So you can write 2 pi rectangle omega by 2t1. Okay. So this is actually the Fourier transform of 2t1. This is not sine, it's a sync. Sync t t1. Okay. So if you simplify this particular equation, you can see that 2, 2 will be cancelled and pi you can move to the left side. So t1 by sync t t1 will be equal to rectangle omega 2 t1. So that is, if there is a signal in frequency domain and the inverse Fourier transform will be a sync function. It's a very important relation. It will be very useful to find the Fourier transform of many signals. So Fourier transform, there is a similarity. That similarity is known as a duality. Okay, duality property. And this example is also very important. Now we'll see how we can prove this particular duality theorem. So now we'll discuss the proof of duality theorem. Okay. So we know the Fourier transform, inverse Fourier transform equation is x of t is 1 pi 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity x of, in place of x of j omega, now I'll use x of omega e raised to j omega t d omega. Okay, you can also write x of j omega, but for the simplicity I'll write x of omega. So this is the inverse Fourier transform equation. Now, if you rearrange, you will get a 2 pi into x of t is equal to integral minus infinity to infinity x of omega. This is capital x of omega e raised to j omega t d omega. This is a frequency domain function, not a time domain signal. So now I can change the variables, changing the variable t to minus t. Okay, so it becomes 2 pi into x of minus t here, and in the right side it's a function of omega, so there is no variable change. You can simply change t with minus t. Okay, so here I am changing t to minus t. So this is a new equation, and in the next step I will change the variable t with omega. So you can write x 2 pi into x of minus omega, which is equal to integral minus infinity to infinity. This is capital X of t into e raised to minus. If you replace omega and t, you will get the same exponential term and dt. Okay. So dt is equal to d omega, and there is no change in the limit. If you closely observe this particular equation, this is similar to your Fourier transform equation. A signal into e raised to minus j omega t. So you can write this is a Fourier transform or continuous time Fourier transform of the signal capital X of t. Okay, so we can conclude the Fourier transform of the signal capital X of t. That's a continuous time Fourier transform of the signal will be 2 pi into x of minus j. So this is a proof of the particular problem. Proof of particular property, duality theorem. Okay. Next lecture, we can discuss some questions related to this duality property.